It's Thursday, so I get my 2 minutes of science. So let's get geeky on the power of plants. We all know that the planet is continuing to warm as more and more greenhouse gases like carbon dioxide are released into the atmosphere each and every day. But while the situation today looks bleak, it could be even worse if it wasn't for plants and trees. That's because according to new research from scientists at Princeton University, plants and trees have absorbed billions of tons of carbon, especially over the last 60 years, that otherwise would have been released into our atmosphere, causing our planet to become red hot. But it wasn't always this way. Between the 1860s and the 1950s, and it's amazing. You go back in when we lived in Vermont, you know, all these forests, we look at all these forests, we think, whoa, look at these forests, these old trees. No, these are, it's almost impossible to find a virgin forest in the United States. And most trees are less than 200 years old. Most of them are less than 100 years old. When we lived in Vermont, I had all these pictures of Montpelier and areas around it. Not a tree on all the mountains. I mean, all these mountains had been totally logged. So between the 1860s and the 1950s, this was the norm, deforestation and logging. And as a result, a lot of carbon got released into the environment instead of being trapped and absorbed by the trees. But in the 1950s, we started using land differently. We started planting more trees and plants. In part, this was from the experience with the Dust Bowl, where we discovered, and this is, you know, FDR put people, this the whole Civilian Conservation Corps, our deforestation, our agriculture practices were causing dust storms. And so the solution, plant trees. So plants overtook many environments that were previously barren and began absorbing billions of tons of carbon. And according to the researchers, just since the mid-20th century, Earth's land-based carbon sink, right, which is the plants and trees that capture carbon, has kept 186 to 192 billion tons of carbon out of our atmosphere. That's amazing when you think about it. I mean, from the Industrial Revolution until today, we've only burned 350 billion tons of carbon. And if 192 billion tons of that has been kept in by plants, then, you know, it's amazing. I mean, just if that carbon sink had not been in place and our planet's ecosystems had remained carbon makers instead of takers, they would have instead generated 65 to 82 billion tons of carbon on top of the carbon they wouldn't have absorbed. In total, that comes out to 250 to 270 roughly billion additional tons of carbon in the atmosphere if it wasn't for the plants and trees. And those numbers would have pushed current carbon dioxide concentrations to 485 parts per million, which is far worse. I mean, we're just over 400 now. Far worse than the scientifically accepted threshold of 450, which is the point at which our climate tips and drastically and irreversibly changes. These findings show how important it is that foliage be taken into account, plants, when we talk about future global warming trends. And the findings make it clear that if we don't do anything to reduce greenhouse gas and carbon emissions in our atmosphere, we're going to need a lot more plants and trees to pick up the slack and maintain Earth's carbon sink. You know, for more on the dangers of climate change and global warming and all that kind of stuff, go over to lasthours.org and check out our new documentary, Last Hours. This was a labor of love that we've worked on for the last almost a year, put this thing together. And I think you'll find it really, really interesting. Lasthours.org. But basically, the bottom line is that we started emitting carbon in a serious way in the 1850s, 1860s. The first commercial oil well was drilled in 1865 in Titusville, Pennsylvania, by Colonel Drake. And, I mean, we were already using oil to some extent at that point. It hadn't been wells. It had been pools and ponds. But we were using mostly a lot of coal. But the Industrial Revolution, oil, it was the perfect storm. And from 1850 to today, we have burned 350 billion tons of carbon and thrown that into the atmosphere as carbon dioxide. 350 billion tons. And more than half of that was absorbed by trees growing because we stopped deforestation. Now, there's a really interesting coincidence here. I remember when I was living in Vermont, and I saw these old pictures and paintings and drawings, but they had some of the early photographs, you know, the daguerreotypes and the early 19th century, the 1900s, the 19-teens, the 1920s, the photography was actually starting to get pretty good. And you find all these old pictures, you know, of Vermont, and it's like the whole state was just naked. And in fact, the main thing, after they took all the trees out in the early 19th century, then the sheep farmers moved in. And the whole state was mostly sheep pasture. People, you know, they made mutton and wool. So I was asking the question, because we had started buying land. We had this house way out in the middle of the woods, and there was a couple of large lots of wooded land that came available contiguous with it that were relatively startlingly inexpensive. We ended up owning, I think, 400 acres of Vermont forest land at one point. And it was all forested. And Louise and I would go out on these long walks in the woods. This was after we had sold the ad agency in Atlanta and before we started the radio show. And so I was just writing books, and I had the time to go out and take a long walk. We get lost. I mean, it was just wonderful. But anyhow, I asked a couple of people who understood the history of the state, why do we have forest now? Why was it naked then? What made the difference? Why did we stop cutting those trees and start letting them grow back? And the answer was coal. The reason the state was denuded is the same reason Rome did this, and they wiped out so many trees that they ended up, this is why the Roman Empire started to expand, was because they ran out of wood, they ran out of firewood, is we were using wood as our primary energy source. We were using wood to power locomotives. If you look at the old pictures of locomotives from the 1850s, 1860s, 1870s, the fuel car behind the locomotive was filled with logs of wood. We were using wood to power steam engines. We were using wood to heat houses. And then we got really good at digging coal out of the ground, and the railroad lines got laid all the way up to Vermont, finally in about 1880, 1890. And when the railroad lines got laid up to Vermont in the 1890s, they were able to bring coal up from the coal mines down in West Virginia and in Pennsylvania. And when they brought the coal up, Coal is much more efficient at producing heat than wood, so a much smaller amount of coal is necessary to warm your house, and people started building bigger houses. And you see around 1880, 1890, 1900, suddenly the house size in Vermont doubled, and people stopped logging the forests, and the forests came back. And this wasn't just Vermont. I mean, this was all over the country this was happening. So what's interesting is that during this time that we started throwing carbon into the air from the 1850s to today, during this time, from 1850 until, well, really from 1870, 1880, up until the 1950s, we were also starting to grow back our forests, and then we started aggressively growing them back after the 30s, so into the 50s. The forests started getting big enough and old enough that they were really soaking up this carbon. So that 350 billion tons of carbon that we've put into the atmosphere that's raised our temperature 1 degree Celsius, half of it is now in those young trees, those 100-year-old trees. But we're not, you know, reforesting any new lands. So I think this is looking like a curve, you know.
This is the Thom Hartmann Program.
It's like that kind of J curve, that spike, because the trees are, you know, not expanding faster than our carbon production.